Just look at what we're doing. We're building, we want to build in Poland 7-10 rather silos for a missile shield. Okay? It's going to cost probably $100 billion. Who is it for? We say it's because of Iranian missiles. There is no country on earth that would dare attack us because we could destroy them totally with one Trident submarine. So why are we spending $100 billion in Poland? The Europeans aren't going to be spending that. Russia only spends 5% of our defense budget. China only spends 5% of our budget. Here, Britain, 5% of our budget. France, 5% of our budget. The rest of probably all of Europe spends 5% of our budget. We spend more than all the rest of the world put together on defense.
We're insane.
Where's the threat?
I understand that we spend a lot more money than all other countries, but could this be economic relativity based on GDP? Like, how much of a percent of GDP do you believe is good to spend on national defense, of the U.S. GDP, our economy, not looking at other economies?
That's irrelevant. When you have a third of your children that do not graduate from high school, what are you talking about? We should be spending whatever our GDP should require so that we are number one in education.
Oh, I agree with you. I mean, we have completely different opinions on education, but I agree we need to seriously reform the education system and provide education to low-income families that are being neglected, and particularly minority families in inner cities. I agree with you there, but I was just curious because what is the main purpose of government? Is it to defend the citizenry or provide to the citizenry?
Well, first off, what is there to defend? It's not a threat. So what is there to defend? We can cut our defense budget by 65%. Talking about percentage of GDP in a world where there's not a threat is an irrelevant statement.
All right. Well, I'll try to bring it back, I guess, to domestic issues a little bit since we're a little short on time here. But you support a national referendum or national initiative.
Referendum. Any legislative body can refer anything it wants to the people. I want to empower the people to be able to make laws and repeal laws.
And what if these laws are in some instances unconstitutional? How would you deal with that problem?
Unconstitutional, the Supreme Court could reverse it. Why can't you? Of course, there's no difference between people making laws and the Congress making laws. There's no difference there. But here again, now the people under my plan would be able to amend the Constitution also, just like the Congress can amend the Constitution.
And what would be the standard for them to amend the Constitution? Like how many votes how many votes would be required?
Take two national votes 6 months apart and no longer than a year apart.
Wouldn't this lead to what Jefferson feared, the dictatorship of the majority to some extent?
No, not at all. Jefferson felt the people should be able to make laws. So did Washington. So did Madison. So did Wilson. So did Ben Franklin. They all did. All the founders felt the people should be able to make laws and amend the Constitution. I've got quotes of those ad nauseum in my book, Citizen Power, which you can get, citizen-power.us. It's $20, and it will inform you. You'll become authorities on the subject.
And I agree with you that we need to continue pushing for more initiative and referendum in the states and possibly even on the national level.
On the national level. What Cicero pointed out 2,000 years ago, that if you want freedom, you have to participate in power. What is the central power of a democracy? It's the power to make laws. So if you can't make laws on the national level, you're not free. You people have been deluding yourself thinking you're free.
Right.
Power.
Well, that might be an understanding of definition of liberty, because Benjamin Constant, the French philosopher after the French Revolution, wrote how the ancients, those in the past, focused on political liberty. They had complete say in the country. They had complete voter rights. They were able to draft all legislation, and whether you're the farmer or the rich businessman. He basically said, though, but today, as there are no more city-states, today as we have large nations and more understanding of democracy, the liberty is economic, and we have representative governments.
Wait, so who said that?
Benjamin Constant. He's a French philosopher. He was talking about how this is why today our liberty is more focused on the individual and not the collective as a whole being able to vote on issues. And my only thing with the referendum and initiative and referendum and the Constitution, constitutional changes, is that if individuals have only 1 year, couldn't there be a lot of moral coercion and national sway, even just in the time of 1 year, that would shut off the voice of the minority?
Well, wait a second. You had a very fundamental point. Mm-hmm. You either believe in majoritarian decision or minority decision.
I believe in majoritarian, but I believe in also protecting the minority voice. It should not be shut out.
The minority is protected by law. The majority is protected by its numbers. Now, if you think that you either have the majority rule or minority rule, take your choice. You can't have both.
Well, I, Senator Gravel, I appreciate your service so much. Thank you so much for what you're doing. And
you want to answer that question to yourself because it's a question in conscience.
Yes, sir. I do believe in majority rule. I'm just always going to be considerate, and I do not want to oppress upon minority rights. And sometimes laws can do that, even laws that we see just.
And you have never seen direct democracy in this country. You have only seen representative government, and that's the experience that informs you, unfortunately.
Now, Senator, I have one last question before we leave, and this is on a probably more fun topic, I guess we could say. Your YouTube viral video with the stair and the water pond made a big splash when it came out. There was completely a pun intended there. But could you explain to us some of the significance and meaning behind that ad for some of the people that have been wondering about it?
That's a metaphor that applies to you, applies to me, and every other human being. What you do is you try to focus on something that's important in your life, you go out and do it, and you hope it's a beneficial experience to others. That's a ripple in the water, and you go off to your demise.
Oh, see, I thought it was you taking, like, the rock of the establishment and special interests and just throwing it in the water. That's what I thought. You're taking care of business and getting rid of all the garbage in D.C. That's what I thought it was symbolic of, but... But anyway, Senator Gravel, thank you so much for your time. I wish you the best of luck with the Libertarian nomination. And again, thank you for so much working for an accountable and transparent government in the Senate for all those years. Truly, truly appreciate it, sir.
One final thing in closing when it comes to the whole majority having a say. And that's what I was trying to say, is that you have to be conscious of the minority. And even just within 1 year, the majority can really shut out the minority due to, like, public sway or something big happens or a tragic event. And one thing I think Senator Gravel might want to look at on his positions is the fact that he is for hate crimes legislation. Hate crimes legislation can extend to so much.
Right.
And it can really curtail speech, because the problem is, what is hate? It's morally relative. It is morally relative to coercion. So should we really legislate that? Should we really legislate what can't harm me physically? You have to be cautious, even on issues like that, and protecting the minority voice.
Well, not to mention he's for gay marriage, and he's definitely a big fan of Brown v. Board. And I don't think either of those things could have happened if we had a national referendum. If you do it on gay marriage now, or if you have done Brown v. Board back in 1954 as a national referendum, it would definitely have been killed.
Right. It's the benevolence of our legislature and the way the framework is laid out and how there's checks and balances even within the legislature allows our minority and our minority rights to be protected. And so we should never forget about that. But anyways, we have to wrap this up. It's been a pleasure. It's been a lively discussion. Check out youtube.com/boilingpointradio. I think we'll be able to get this interview up soon. Anyways, take care, y'all. Have a blessed day. This is Tenacious Tex Dozier.
And this is James Connelly. You've been listening to The Boiling Point on WHBK 88.5 Chicago, Illinois.